فلا هادي له، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، فإن كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار، وإنما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين. إن شاء الله we continue tonight with reading from the book صحيح الترغيب والترهيب by Sheikh Muhammad Nasir Adil Albani rahmatullah alayhi, Allah's mercy on his soul. Ameen. Today we inshallah we have a new chapter, which the book of knowledge, Kitab al-Ilmi, At-Targhib fi al-Ilmi wa Talabihi. This the book of knowledge, encouragement of seeking knowledge, learning, teaching, and whatever is related to the virtues of knowledge and the superiority of the scholars and the students of knowledge. And before we start this chapter, we have to understand that whenever we're talking about virtues of knowledge and reward of those who seeking knowledge, we talking about knowledge which leads to Allah and His Messenger. We are not saying that it's haram to learn the knowledge of the dunya and the way how to utilize things in the dunya, but we have to distinguish between things and put everything in the proper perspective. So it is permissible for a person to learn science, mathematics, chemistry, things which he can utilize and be able to use this life and to be able to benefit himself and benefit others. But there is a other knowledge which is much superior than this knowledge, which Allah is talking about it, as well as His Messenger, concerning the reward. And this is the knowledge which is related to Allah, or related to the Deen of Allah, or related to anything that concerning this Deen of Islam. We start with Hadith Muawiyah, may Allah be pleased with him. If you have it there.
No. Okay. Muawiyah radiallahu anhu narrated that the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if Allah wants to do good to a person, He makes him a canonist of religion. Compiled by Al-Bukhari and Muslim.
The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying, مَن يُرِدِ اللَّهُ بِهِ خَيْرًا يُفَقِّهُ فِي الدِّينِ. He, Allah wishes good for someone. When Allah wishes good for someone, He bestows upon him the understanding of the deen, the religion. That there is a learning of the knowledge and there is understanding of the knowledge. Learning the knowledge, i.e. memorization, or compiling, this is learning, studying, listening, recording, writing, lecturing, all this part of the learning. But this is a step. There is a greater and more important step is the understanding of the knowledge. To know what Allah meant, what His Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam meant, is not every hadith and every verse that understood by reading. There is some of them which has rules and regulation, and it require more depth in the understanding of the deen in general, the Arabic and the grammar, and other things which are related. So hadith here is talking about fiqh fi deen, to understand the ruling about things, the mechanism of doing certain things. This was the hadith is talking about. So here that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala attends good for somebody, the sign of it is not that a person have more money than others or bigger house than others, but is the understanding in the religion, the fiqh of the deen, the understanding of the deen. Because a person can compile a lot of money and can have a lot of money, but maybe intentionally or unintentionally he acquires this knowledge from haram resources, and this will be very serious. So the understanding of learning the halal and the haram, how to earn the money and how to spend the money, because learning the halal and the haram is an important understanding in the deen of Allah. Nevertheless, that Allah did not make the sign of loving a person or attending good to him, getting money, houses, many children, because we can see this even with non-Muslims. Even some of the non-Muslims, they have more wealth and more children or more houses than Muslims. But the deen and the understanding of the deen is the absolute sign that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it for a person whom Allah intends something good to him. There is another hadith with similar, which was the same narration. يا أيها الناس إنما العلم بالتعلم. O people, knowledge is by learning. Do you have this one?
No.
Okay. والفقه بالتفقه. And the understanding in the deen is by learning and studying. And whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intends good for him, he will give him the understanding in the deen. Then it said, إنما يخشى الله من عباده العلماء. Indeed, more fearful to Allah are the scholars. The scholars supposed to have the more taqwa, and they fear Allah more because they get to know more about Allah, the ability of Allah, the greatness of Allah. Okay? So, which is this brings more taqwa in their hearts to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the scholars are the one who have more khashya and more fear of Allah than anyone else. Nevertheless, here is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam showing us that we need to take the means to the goals that we try to achieve. About ilm, you have to learn. You could not stay in your house and assume yourself that you're going to learn. And fiqh also by seeking understanding. Okay? So it has to be a person taking means towards going to school, recording the knowledge, listening to it, try to memorize it. Otherwise, if the early Sahaba and the Tabi'een did not do this, we could not have this hadith nowadays. And they have a difficult time more than our time. They some of them used to write, you understand, in rocks, in skin of animals, and some of them, you understand, they to have a collection of some hadith, they have to have their camel or their donkey to put it on top of them. And if you compare this to us today, having a CD that you put it between two fingers that have all the six books of hadith and the Quran and the tafsir. But those people had appreciated the little bit that they have, and they made a great sacrifice to keep the things. Allah gave us more than what He gave them, but He found that we have more zuhd in the deen and more love for the dunya than the knowledge of the deen. Next hadith, which hadith by Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman, may Allah be pleased with him.
Hudhayfa ibn al-Muhammad. Hudhayfa.
Superiority.
Yeah.
Okay.
Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman, radiyallahu anhu, narrated that the Prophet of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, said, "The virtue of knowledge is better than the virtue of worship, and the best deed of your religion is the piety." Compiled by Al-Hakim.
Hudhayfa, may Allah be pleased with him, stated the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying, "Fadlu al-ilmi khayru min fadli al-ibadah, wa khayru dinikum al-wara'." The virtues or the superiority of knowledge is more that seeking knowledge, learning the deen, the orders of Allah, the knowledge, the sunnah of Rasulullah sallam, learning this is greater than the reward of ibadah. Okay? Why? Because you could not make ibadah without knowledge. And if you make ibadah without knowledge, you will be like a person who building without a foundation. And if you don't have a foundation, you could not erect your building. So if you want to get married, you have to know what the rules and regulations, what the duties, what is the rights. Otherwise, maybe somebody would be marry a woman which is haram for him to marry, or that he stay from a woman that he love because he assumes that it's haram for him to marry her, like, as example, his first cousin. So according to culture or people brought up in this country, first cousin is haram, is bad or evil to marry, okay? But Islamically is halal for you, alright? So anything in Islam is built on knowledge. So you could not worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without knowledge. This is the foundation. As a result of this, learning became is more superior than worshipping. Then, if you got the deen, the best thing in the deen is the wara'. And wara', what you call piety, is more than piety. In wara', a person avoiding things which is even maybe halal, out of fear of falling into doubtful things. Okay? That he will leave what is no doubtful, fearing that he may fall in the doubtful things. Okay? This is called wara'. So it's not clear to you. You don't have the proper understanding about it. So you say, okay, forget about this dollar that coming from that a gray area, or I'm not sure about it. Why? Because you don't want to engage in the haram. Alright? Next hadith, which hadith Abu Huraira. Thus, all this hadith is related to the superiority of knowledge, to show you how important it is to dedicate your time or part of your time to learn. And the person has to approach this deen according what is more important. So you could not go and learn about Salah before you know about Aqidah and Tawheed. Because if you don't have the proper tawheed, your salah is not going to be accepted. A person go be concerned about learning about business or economics in Islam, and after this the person doesn't know how to do the proper wudu. You see? So we have to see what is more important, what is more to have to priority in our learning. Basic things of the deen first. Know about the shahada and how to avoid the shirk, what types of shirk. Because if you have shirk, even if you pray every day, your salah is not going to be helping you. Because Allah, إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّلُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. Allah only accepts you from the pious one. Those who avoid evil, avoid shirk, avoid bid'ah. You see? So it's very important that we make time and we have concern that we devote some of our time to learn about the deen of Allah and learning about what's pleasing to Allah, what is pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the next hadith for our chapter reported by Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him.
Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "He who alleviates the grief of a brother out of the griefs of the world, Allah will alleviate his grief on the day of resurrection. He who conceals the faults of a Muslim, Allah will conceal his faults in this world and in the hereafter. He who finds relief for one who is hard pressed, Allah will make things easy for him in this world and in the hereafter. Allah helps a man so long as the man helps his brother. He who goes along in a path in search for knowledge, Allah will make that path easy for him to reach paradise. And whenever people assemble in a mosque among the masajid of Allah in order to recite the book of Allah, to learn and teach the Quran among themselves, angels would surround them, tranquility would descend upon them, mercy would cover them, and Allah would highly praise them in the presence of those near him. And he who is slow-paced in doing good deeds, his high descent would not make him go ahead." Rawahul Muslim.
Jazakallah khairan. This hadith which is reported by Abu Huraira radiallahu an, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying, "Man nafasa an mu'minin qurba min qurabi dunya nafasa Allahu anhu qurbatan min qurabi yawm al-qiyamah." So there is a hardship in this life, and also there is a hardship in the hereafter. But all this hardship that we face in this dunya, you could not compare it to the hereafter. You see? But nevertheless, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made relief in somebody's hardship means of relief in your hardship in the day of judgment. And of course, you could not compare this hardship, you understand, or difficulty of this dunya with anything of the hereafter. There is no comparison, okay? But it is a means and ways for those people who want the real hardship and difficulty to be relieved from it in the day of judgment, to go about trying to help those people who are in hell. And also, that Muslims been encouraged to cover the faults of each other. As a result of this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will cover their faults in the hereafter. Then the issue here, well, this hadith here, because a part of it relates to our subject. من سلك طريقا يلتمس فيه علما سهل الله له به طريقا إلى الجنة. Whosoever take a path towards a knowledge, wherever you go, if it is in a house, in a school, in a mosque, in an institution, seeking the knowledge, okay, the deen of Allah, the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah will make a means for him by this way that he went to make Jannah easy for him. He will achieve it. Why? Because you're supposed to learn what in the knowledge about what's halal, what's haram, what's pleasing to Allah, what's displeasing to Allah. When you learn these things and you act upon it, now you will found your way became paved towards Jannah. Okay? We are not learning only to memorize, but you learn so you know what is right and what's wrong, what's halal, what's haram, what is kufr, what is shirk, what is sunnah, what is bid'ah. And now you're going to act on the haram, you stay away from the bid'ah, you develop your iman, you stay away from shirk. So now became your way and your road to Jannah became easier for you. Then it shows us again the virtues of sitting in the house of Allah, studying the deen of Allah, discussing the knowledge of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his sunnah. Okay? That if a people sits in one of the houses of Allah, i.e. a mosque, now the angels will surround them. Now the sakina and the tranquility will descend on them, and the mercy will cover them. And in addition to this, Allah will mention them in the highest of all places, among the angels. That means Allah will be proud with those people. Okay? Because they sat in the house of Allah only for purpose of mentioning Allah's name and learning the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The hadith had concluded by saying, وَمَنْ بَطَّأَ بِهِ عَمَلُهُ لَمْ يُسْرِعْ بِهِ نَسَبُهُ. That the one who's slow in his action, okay, his high rank and family name is not going to make a means for him to Jannah. Okay, doesn't matter who you are and who's your father, what tribe you're from, this is not. But your iman and your knowledge, your action, your good deed, this is what's going to make a way for you and rank for you in Jannah. So if somebody is slow in their ibadah, in their practice of the deen, being a Sayyid or Sharif or Arab or whatever, is not going to help them. Okay? And we know that the uncle of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he is his uncle, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that تَبَّتْ يَدَا أَبِي لَهَبٍ وَتَبْ. Okay? And he is the uncle of the Prophet. And this is Quran is going to be recited until the day of the judgment. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that he's a loser, perished, and he's going to be in hellfire. Alright? Next hadith, hadith by Abu Darda, may Allah be pleased with him.
Abu Darda radiallahu anhu narrated, I heard the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, he who goes along in a path in search of knowledge, Allah will facilitate to him to reach paradise. The angels will lower their wings in their great pleasure with one who seeks knowledge. The inhabitants of the heavens and the earth and the fish in the deep water ask forgiveness for the true Islamic scholar. The superiority of the true Islamic scholar over the devout is like that of the moon over the rest of the star. The true Islamic scholars are the heirs of the prophets. Certainly the prophets left neither dinar nor dirham as something to be inherited, but they left knowledge, and he who takes it surely takes an abundant portion. Rawahul Abi Dawood.
Okay. Hadith which reported by Abu Darda, may Allah be pleased with him, saying, سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول من سلك طريقا يلتمس فيه علما سهل الله له طريقا إلى الجنة. So this is the same phrase that we just have it in the other hadith before this, that you go for searching of knowledge, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes this journey and this effort ease your way to Jannah, because you're going to learn about your way, how to go to Jannah. Okay? Then, again, a virtue of a person who seeks knowledge, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes the angels lower their wings, okay, for the person who doing such great job. Why? Because he went to seek the knowledge. There is nothing can be better than you going seeking the knowledge, learning about Allah and His deen. And the angels, they do this because they please with what he's doing. His goal, his target is what? Learning about the deen. Okay? This is the student of knowledge. The student of knowledge. The angels lower their wing for him. As for the scholar, now the scholar, the creation of Allah, seeking forgiveness for him. And he's saying that those on the heaven or in the earth, even the fish in the water, subhanallah, okay, seeking forgiveness for the scholar. Why? Because now he is in position to teach, to preach, to guide the people. So he found all these living things, they are in the heaven or they are in the earth. Okay? Above the sky or on the ground or under, even in the water. Subhanallah. So we look to these things, that the trees and ants and fish as things only to living things. But you don't know how they make prayer for you. Subhanallah. How Allah inspires them to make istighfar for you, because the great job that you're doing. Okay? Even the fish in the water. And the superiority of a knowledgeable person than a person who worshiping Allah. Because the person who's worshiping Allah, he's only getting credit for himself. He's not contributing anything to anybody else. He's only trying to benefit his own self. But the scholar, he's guiding the people. He's contributing. Okay? So two different things. One is only benefit his own self, while the other person is extending hand for others, giving them direction, giving them the light, giving them the way to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the difference between a student and a scholar. Alright? He said his superiority like the moon. Okay? You can compare the moon and the size and the light to the other stars and things like this. You can see the difference. Okay? Then, listen to this. وَإِنَّ الْعُلَمَاءِ وَرَثَةُ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ. Indeed, the scholars are the heirs of the prophets. Like when your father died and you inherit something from him. Okay? So this was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam left. And everybody, if you, your father or your grandfather or a relative of you have lands and houses and cattle and he died, you go and you demand your right. Okay? You don't want anybody, everybody get his share. Where is mine? And sometimes even people go to court, taking their uncles, their brothers, understand, to court because they did not give them their share or whatever. But when it comes about demanding your right from the inheritance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he found many Muslims, they are not worried about it. Don't worry about it, okay? You can take my share, I don't need it. Okay? We are not paying attention to this. Subhanallah. But imagine yourself that your father, he owns this village, everything. 10 buildings and hundreds of acres and all these cattle. Even if you are not their home, when he dies, you make a power of attorney for somebody, make sure that he will go to the court and get your share. You understand? But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he left all this inheritance behind him. Every Muslim is supposed to demand his share. But people turn to something else. They are not even concerned about, you understand? But the amazing thing, you understand, if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam have some clothes left or some furniture, okay, everybody will try to get this because they understand, sees, feel the barakah. They want to get the blessing, okay? This is the things, this is the pillows that the Prophet lay down on it. This is the clothes that touches the body of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, okay? Everybody want to get this, or people even go all the way to Turkey to see, you say, okay, the cup of the Prophet that he used to drink from it. It's there in a museum. Go spend $5,000 and make a trip to go to see this. But what about what the Prophet said? The teaching of the Prophet. Why nobody fighting over it? You see? No, no, there's no need for a fight. It's available there, okay? That people are not showing too much concern. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam telling us that al-ulama warathatul anbiya, the scholars are the people who inherit the prophets. Why? Because this is the people who concern about learning. But he said, وَإِنَّ الْأَنْبِيَاءَ لَمْ يُوَرِّثُوا دِينَارًا وَلَا دِرْهَمًا. The Prophet didn't leave anything in solid stuff. It's not a dinar, dollar, a dirham, gold, silver. Okay? If this is what you're going to be searching for, this is not what the Prophet left behind. Okay? You want to demand your rights, there is something else. Okay? إِنَّمَا وَرَّثُوا الْعِلْمِ. What the Prophet left behind them? Knowledge. This was the Prophet left, okay? That whosoever go and possess, go after it, indeed he got the greatest, okay? He got the right thing, alright? But today, if somebody said in the newspaper that we discovered the spoon, or the cup, or the handkerchief, or the pillow of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we're making a bid, you understand? And you go to start to see, understand, it going like crazy like this. 5,000, 10,000, 20,000, okay, 50,000. What about, Sahih al-Bukhari, you can get the whole thing in one CD, you understand, $20. You can get all this ahadith and tafsir and this. Oh brother, I don't have time. Oh brother, I have a lot of CDs. Oh brother, if I need, I think I can search it in Google, I can find it there. Okay? Things become so available, but still, subhanAllah, most of the Muslims, they are not worried about it. You can read every day about the newspaper. What happened in Iraq, what happened in Palestine, what happened in Shishna, what happened in Amit, what happened in China, and all these things. But for somebody to open the hadith and even read one hadith a day, most of us, we don't have this. But we're so concerned to learn and to hear the news every day, even if he's so busy, okay? They go to something called the head news, only read the title, at least know what's going on. What about what was going on there? This is here. This is your future, you understand? So the Prophet ﷺ said that the Anbiya, the Prophet, the Messenger, they didn't leave behind them dinar, money, wealth, anything like this. But they left the knowledge. So those people who are eager to be having part of the wealth or the hell, the inheritance of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, all what they need to open the book of Allah and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Hadith Safwan, if you have it. Safwan ibn Assal, he say, أتيت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم هو في المسجد متكئ على برد له أحمر فقلت له يا رسول الله إني جئت أطلب العلم فقال مرحبا بطالب العلم إن طالب العلم تحفه الملائكة وتظله بأجنحتها ثم يركب بعضها حتى بعضا حتى يبلغ السماء الدنيا من محبتهم لما يطلب. Okay? That this Sahabi, may Allah be pleased with him, Safwan ibn Assal, he came, he said, I reached and I found the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam leaning in the mosque, okay, with a stripe, soap, stripe, red color, said, O Prophet of Allah, I came. So it seems that he's coming from another town or other location, okay? Said, O Prophet of Allah, I came for purpose of seeking the knowledge. You want to learn, okay? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, welcome to the student of knowledge. Subhanallah. Can you imagine if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tell you welcome? Okay? He say welcome. And he welcome in who? The student of the knowledge. Then he said, indeed, the seeker of knowledge, the angels well surrounded him, okay, with their wings. In another narration, it will shelter him, okay. Then they became on top of each other, that the angels, until they reach all the way to the sky, from because they in love of what he seeking. Like you understand, you have a what you call it, like a star person, you call
superstar.
Can you imagine? Understand somebody coming to Colombia? He's a superstar, basketball singer, crazy, whatever it is. Because people superstar nowadays and all kind of crazy things. And you can imagine, okay, how many people will be there in the airport waiting? You understand, for somebody to sign autograph, or that only can see that he will wait for them, or that only to touch their hands like this, fast and quick. Huh? Superstar. So the student of knowledge, the angels comes so crowded over him, surrounded him, all right, because they so happy, okay, because they so happy with what he coming to see, and they became so much, they will be on top of each other until they reach the sky, the lowest heaven. Subhanallah. Can you imagine? Can you imagine yourself feeling this position, that you superstar coming to some place and everybody there coming to welcome you? You are not talking about a human being like you. You're talking about angels. And not an angel, an angels. And the Prophet ﷺ said, there's so much coming surrounding this person who come for this person, this purpose, until they riding over each other, so crowded, until they reach the lowest heaven. Subhanallah. The next hadith, which hadith reported by Anas, talabul ilmi farida ala kulli muslim. Seeking the knowledge is an obligation. Is an obligation upon every Muslim. Okay? This doesn't matter if you are a male or female. Because a man have to pray, a woman have to pray. Haram for a man to eat pork, haram for a woman to eat pork. Okay? So a male is obligated in Islam, and a female are obligated in Islam. So both of them have to learn. And what we're talking about, how much you're supposed to learn, at least a minimum of things to make your ibadah correct. As example, if now I have money, so now I have obligated to give zakah. So now the knowledge of zakah became obligatory on me, so I can know how to give the zakah and how much is zakah and how to who to distribute it, all these things. All right? If a person, you understand, he doesn't have the wealth, so now this is not incumbent about him, but he's about to get married, so now learning about marriage in Islam, according to Islam, now became more obligation on him, more important, and supersede learning about zakah in Islam. Why? Because you're about to act about some of the things which require learning what is the right, what is the duty, dowry, you know, all these things, okay? So you don't go and after this, brother, I didn't know about it, and only got to know about this wali business, but when I asked the sister, would you like me? She said yes, I said yes. So now we became married, we opened the Quran, we bought the Quran, and we bought our hands, she bought her hands, and now we became married, okay? He doesn't know anything about mahr, he doesn't know anything about the garden, he doesn't know anything about witnesses. So the minimum required from every Muslim, because this is obligation. So same way if you pray Dhuhr three rak'at, Salah is not acceptable, okay? You have to know that Dhuhr is four rak'at, and that you have to make wudu, or you have to have wudu, all these things. So the same thing, anything you want to do in Islam, You have to do what? You have to get the knowledge which related to this. And this is the problem nowadays, that you found people, they doing things, they call it jihad, okay, without learning about jihad. And now they make the name of Muslims and Islam became something bad in front of the people. Okay? Who taught you about jihad? And did you know the rules of jihad? And do you know when it can be jihad, when not be jihad? No, they don't know. So Islam is not about emotion. You act according to emotion and say, brother, okay, this you understand, kuffar, no, I'm go. You understand their money is halal and you go rob a bank and do these things and say, I'm doing jihad. Jihad, who taught you this jihad? Okay? No, he gets in things, okay? So here's the Prophet saying that seeking the knowledge of the deen is obligation upon every Muslim. So which knowledge? Do I have to know how to pronounce this? Do how we understand to go the grammar in the Arabic? The minimum that you need to learn how to correct your ibadah. So as example, if you are new shahada, now you know in 2 months, as example, Ramadan is going to be approaching. And you busy sitting reading in the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ or the seerah, the history of the Sahaba. This is not the time for you to read the history of the Sahaba. You got something obligatory coming in a couple of months and you shahada, you don't know about fasting. You see? So we have to have priority in our life because you could not worship Allah with emotion or according good intention, but you don't have the proper knowledge. We're going to have to stop here, inshallah, and we'll continue next week, if Allah will. Thank you for being here. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik. نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك اللهم صل
الله أكبر والله أكبر الله أكبر والله